In our search for extraterrestrial intelligence, we examine the stars hoping to find something in those tiny islands of warmth amid the vast ocean of night. But what if we are looking in the wrong place? It's been a bit less than a century since we realized that our galaxy was not synonymous with the universe, and that some of the hazy nebula we could see were far larger and further away than we'd assumed, cousins to our own galaxy. It took us much longer to group these into clusters, and eventually superclusters, and to see the underlying structure connecting those galaxies, in filaments like a vast spider web, or foam of soap bubbles filled in between with far larger volumes of neo-emptiness. We began calling these voids, and soon discovered a truly enormous one that was subsequently named the Buddhist Void or Great Void. It's so big, at over 300 million light-years across, that there was a lot of doubt if it could have been formed naturally within the cosmological models of the time. This inevitably led a lot of folks to wonder if it might in fact be unnatural in origin. One of the most common questions I get on this channel is if this might be part of the solution to the Fermi paradox, so I thought it was past time we discussed that option. If you're not a channel regular, the Fermi paradox is the apparent contradiction between how big and old the universe is and the seeming absence of any other intelligent life in it. Or basically, if the universe is teeming with alien civilizations, where is everyone? If you are a channel regular, then you know that one of our add-ons that further exacerbates the paradox is the Dyson Dilemma, the assumption that colonizing space is practical and something most species will do, and that any star system they can colonize, beginning with their own that they evolved in, should eventually fill up with various habitats, solar power collectors, and machinery so as to use up all of the sunlight produced by that star, what we call a Dyson Swarm, or Kardashev 2 civilization. The Dyson Dilemma doesn't ask why we aren't getting any signals when we look at distant stars, it asks why we can see any other stars at all. As long as it takes to colonize a galaxy, it's very little time compared to the age of those galaxies, and a very long time compared to even fairly anemic population growth rates. And we expect to see dark bubbles emerging inside galaxies and slowly expanding outwards as system after system was colonized and its sun slowly darkened as more of its power was put to use by the growing civilization around it. This would eventually eat up an entire galaxy, what's called a Kardashev 3 civilization, and there's no reason they have to stop with just one galaxy. There are some assumptions required for this reasoning, like that a civilization desires to grow, and it's dependent on matter and energy to do so, and we've addressed them in detail in our episode, The Dyson Dilemma. That was actually our first episode on the channel, so I recommend watching the remade version of it rather than the original. It's a fairly central concept to a lot of our discussion on the channel, so it's no surprise that folks will often think vast expanding bubble of darkness and look at the voids, which are vast expanding bubbles of darkness, and wonder if the solution is just that simple. Maybe those voids aren't empty expanses, but rather the most densely populated regions of our universe, giant empires far larger than even a Kardashev 3 civilization, sprawling over many thousands of galaxies. It's a very attractive notion on first glance, and we'll get to the flaws in a moment. But what tipped me into finally doing an episode on the matter was that there's something in the basic concept itself that deserves a second look. Or rather, that the empty places in the galaxy deserve a first look. The universe may be huge, and contains billions of galaxies each hosting billions of stars, but if you point a telescope in any random direction, you usually won't be aimed directly at a star. Trace a straight line out from Earth in a random direction, and you get to the edge of the observable universe before it passed through a star most of the time, because there's an awful lot of nothing, and space is absurdly big. Knowing this to be the case, we understandably focus our search for life near stars, since it's a lot of space to search, and anything you can do to narrow it down helps. Yet there's actually an awful lot of something in these places, And we've talked before about colonizing things like our Oort cloud, so maybe we should be considering searching them as well. More on that in a bit, but first, let's talk voids. As I said, these are expanding empty blobs of dark space, and that's exactly what we would expect under the Dyson Dilemma. However, that's not quite right. First, they are not completely empty. Just as the space between galaxies is quite sparse but still contains many stars, the voids do include a fair number of galaxies, and generally have a mass density of about 10% of what we consider the universal norm. It'd be weird to assume species expanding into those areas would opt to arbitrarily bypass entire galaxies, particularly considering we see this everywhere in the universe. We would also need to assume such voids were the product of many different emerging civilizations who not share the same reasons for bypassing galaxies. So too, we see their gravitational effect on nearby galaxies outside the voids, but there's no indication there's a ton of secret mass concealed inside Dyson swarms. The other part of that is that Dyson swarms don't actually conceal stars, they only change the frequency of light they emit. You build one to tap its energy, but that eventually gets emitted as waste heat, and if it didn't, everyone inside would be rapidly incinerated. That waste heat would be emitted as infrared light, corresponding to somewhere around room temperature or colder. Folks tend to view a Dyson swarm as akin to a dam on a river, where the sunlight is the water, but it's more like a water wheel, where the water does its job, then continues on. In this case, it comes in as visible sunlight and is transmuted into infrared, invisible to our eyes, but easily seen by our telescopes, and actively searched for by scientists in the field of Dysonian SETI. Of course, even a dam only holds water to a point, and for the same reason, once it hits maximum capacity, it overflows or bursts the dam. I'll put one caveat on that though. We often figure there's a chance a civilization exploiting a galaxy isn't actively using most of it, but rather storing a lot of it for long-term use to survive the black hole era after the stars are burned out. And indeed, we have discussed how you could go about disassembling stars to harvest them for matter through star lifting, as well as creating artificial black holes to use as ultra-long-lasting and hyper-efficient batteries. That's not really producing much waste heat, and you do have a strong motivation in a post-biological civilization to try to minimize power use and keep your territory very cold, as it lets you do vastly more efficient computation, which is the lifeblood of such digital empires. See the Civilizations at the End of Time series for details. Folks often wonder if they might just have a way to avoid producing waste heat. And of course, we can never rule out that some civilization might figure out a way to break the laws of thermodynamics. However, in this case, that doesn't help. You build these huge stellar engines because you need their vast amounts of matter and energy. If your civilization can break the laws of thermodynamics, you have no motivation to build a Dyson swarm because you don't need that matter and energy. You literally have perpetual motion machines and free lunches. You'd also still be detectable by the gravity this region would exert on its more visible neighbors. You can't hide that either, if you learn to block gravity somehow, any more than you can hide Earth's early radio transmissions. The evidence of that gravity's existence will be plain to see in its past effects before you learn to conceal it somehow. The next big one is time. In our discussions of the Fermi paradox, we developed a concept called T, the time elapse argument, which basically argues that any puzzling phenomena we think might be artificial, and which we see lots of examples from all across the universe, should be more common the closer to us that we look. Astronomy is history. If you're looking at something a billion light years away, you are seeing it as it was a billion years ago. Alternatively, anything artificial that's all over the universe is presumably something a lot of civilizations opt to build, and we should see more of them as the universe ages, and those civilizations have more time to build them, and more of them arise to build them. Quasars, for instance, were more common in the past. We see a higher density of them the further off we look. so they're not likely to be artificial in origin. Similarly, anything we see really far away probably can't be artificial simply because the universe would be so young there as we see it today. If you see something 10 billion light years away, in terms of the light's age, it would be from when the universe was younger than the Earth is now, and thus not likely to be the product of some vast super civilization. Now, I did say the voids were expanding, which argues a similar notion. Something getting bigger as time goes on hits the basic profile for it being artificial. However, the problem is the whole universe is expanding, and the voids match that rate. And furthermore, we can see them emerging as far back as we can look in time, which is so early that nothing could possibly have evolved yet, even ignoring that the universe was a hot and dense place, entirely hostile to life at that point. Though it is possible a little later than that, in what sometimes gets called the bathwater period, life might have evolved, something we'll address in the upcoming Fermi Paradox episode on panspermia. Indeed, that episode is part of the reason that this one is being done as a bonus episode, since I didn't want to displace other topics from our schedule with too heavy a focus on the Fermi Paradox. It's also being done because that's more or less the end of the arguments, making for a short episode by this channel's standards. Voids are not hidden K3 civilizations, because we don't see their waste heat, and according to known physics, that can't be possible. Voids are not hidden K3 civilizations, because we don't see their hidden galaxies exerting any gravitational telltales on regions bordering those voids. Voids are not hidden K3 civilizations, because they aren't devoid of galaxies, just low on them. They've been explained as a natural phenomena, simply the result of the universe not being quite evenly distributed when it began, and the matter clumping up under the influence of gravity. We're still debating and theorizing about why the universe was anisotropic, not evenly distributed, when it began, but we know it was, and whatever caused that predated any intelligence in this universe, at least which originated in this universe, and we can't casually rule out that various civilizations might be immigrants from some earlier or parallel universe, but that wouldn't fit with them living in the voids either. They're not vacuuming mass out to their universe in some extreme example of cosmic mining. The expansion of the voids is just an expansion of space, and the decreasing density of matter in them, not the raw quantity of matter in them. Things are spreading out, not disappearing. As to the bigger voids, we believe them just to be mergers of previous smaller voids, which happens with galaxies too. Our own galaxy has cannibalized dozens of smaller ones. And indeed, many of the stars we may one day colonize in the Milky Way might not have originated in this galaxy, or may have been formed by nebula shocked into star production by such mergers. And many of those extragalactic stars I mentioned earlier and have discussed using as waypoints between galaxies in other episodes might have formed here and been ejected by those galactic mergers as well. But a final thought on the matter, in a more general sense. Just as superclusters of galaxies don't contain all our mass, with much in the voids, and just as galaxies don't contain all our stars, with many in the intergalactic void, there is an awful lot of space between the stars in the interstellar voids, and that isn't devoid of mass either. People often debate the notion of Kardashev 2 civilizations and Dyson swarms being inevitable because you don't need stars for energy if you have controlled fusion reactors or something better, like feedable Kugel-Blitz black holes. This isn't an exemption to the Dyson dilemma because we have a pair of assumptions in the concept, that thermodynamics still applies and faster than light travel is not possible, so you'd still harvest stars for their matter, for fuel and building supplies. And you'd also still clump together because you want minimum signal lag time and travel time between everyone. This produces the same net effect, big globes glowing in the infrared spectrum, same as a Dyson swarm. However, this does have one weakness, in that it assumes that you have a signal lag time and care about it. We can't be sure no one is ever going to find a loophole around the speed of light. And communication, just sending info and data rather than mass, would probably be the easiest such loophole to use. in a post-biological civilization, that's all you really need. And as we mentioned earlier, cold is your friend if you're a digital empire. It makes all your power generation more efficient, and makes all your computation more efficient too. In such cases, you don't want to be clumped anymore. You want to be as spread out as you can, to be as cold as you can be. In which case, all those interstellar voids look very attractive as places to live, those intergalactic voids even better, and those super voids best yet. And it would be very hard to spot such civilizations. Even without FTL communication, they might not care about lag time to their neighbors if it's buying them vastly more efficient processing, which essentially means a bigger population in this context anyway. If you recall the episodes where we discussed such civilizations, like Matryoshka brains, you'd already be talking about running whole modern civilizations of billions on a trickle of power, so they'd hardly need to worry about getting lonely because their neighbor civilizations were far away. Or they could be huddled around a black hole in the void, isolating themselves from the larger universe, as we discussed in our Civilizations at the End of Time Black Hole Farming episode. If this is a practical and successful strategy for a long-term civilization, why wait until the universe is dying to do it? So this concept is not without its flaws. You'd still expect them to disassemble stars for raw materials, for instance. But it does leave the door open to the idea that maybe we're looking for signals in the wrong places, that maybe we should take a peek not at the stars, but the vast voids between them. Until next time, thanks for watching, and have a great week.